Hello again, friends. This will be a talk on gastroesophageal reflux disease, otherwise known as GERD, and this is one of the most common, if not perhaps the most common, single complaint that you will ever get in the clinic or in the ER, even for that matter. This is so common, and for that reason, it's very important that you know how to manage this, know some of the differentials, and how to go about treating this. This is very, very, very important. You will get a question or two on the USMLE that pertains to reflux disease. So I suggest that you pay attention to this lecture. If you haven't already, please consider subscribing to my Patreon page at www.patreon.com/PWBMD. You can get there by clicking the link below in the description of the video or in the I button on the upper right-hand corner of the video, and it should link you up. If you could consider chipping in $1 a month, a little bit goes a very long way to help keep these videos free. And if you subscribe, you'll have access to premium content, which includes some of my videos in which I go over case studies, how to formulate a differential diagnosis, treatment plan, things that will come in handy for you as you gear up to study for steps 2 and 3. Thank you very much in advance for your consideration. So this is obviously a re-recording of a lecture that I gave in 2013. Working our way down the digestive tract, I talked about the esophagus. Here we're talking about the lower esophagus and the stomach. Reflux disease kind of involves both of them, but it really pertains to the lower esophageal junction. That is where the pathology is at as far as why this is happening. Now, the consequences of reflux disease is going to particularly involve the lower esophagus. You can get metaplastic changes there, known as Barrett's esophagus, which can ultimately lead to lower esophageal cancer, otherwise known as the adenocarcinoma. So that's the consequence if we don't treat GERD or if we insufficiently treat GERD. So this is some of the causes of epigastric pain. The number one cause is idiopathic, but a close second would be reflux disease. Also, we have peptic ulcer disease, gastritis, pancreatitis, some other things, cancer, which can be a variety of different cancer, or referred or misappropriated pain, pelvic pain being one of those things. Obviously, you ever have a woman come in saying she's got belly pain, she's of reproductive age, you need to get a pregnancy test. So some principles of GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, is what it stands for, and it's the number one identifiable cause of epigastric pain. It is very common. It affects 10 to 20% of people in Western countries, and that incidence will increase as age increases. Some of the risk factors for GERD include obesity. Obviously, there's more pressure on the abdomen, especially with abdominal obesity. Older age, as mentioned, family history for some reason, and a hiatal hernia. Also, certain drugs will relax that lower esophageal sphincter, and those drugs include calcium channel blockers. So look for that. Patients with coronary artery disease who may be on calcium channel blockers, they have an increased risk for GERD. As mentioned, it's due to excessive relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. Remember that that sphincter needs to close in order for food gastric contents to stay in the stomach. Now, we don't want that sphincter to close too tightly, otherwise you'll get what's known as achalasia. So we want it to relax when appropriate and contract when appropriate. And if it does not contract when appropriate, if it's excessive relaxation, you will get backflow into the stomach, and that is going to result in a burning sensation, particularly that radiates up the esophagus and can be described as not only epigastric pain, but substernal pain, a burning pain. Often, as mentioned, it's perceived as substernal pain. It radiates along the tract of the esophagus. Often it's described as burning. Patients may describe it as heartburn. And that's, in fact, what it is. It's heartburn. Other symptoms may include a sore throat with time. This can erode some of the mucosa of the esophagus, and that's going to cause a sore throat. If this gets up high enough and you get a little bit of aspiration, that's certainly going to cause a sore throat. Hoarseness as it affects the larynx if it gets high enough, a cough, wheezing, a bad taste in the mouth. A lot of times it's described as a metallic taste. And as you get a little bit better at seeing patients with GERD and their symptoms, you'll begin to develop a nose for GERD. It's got a very particular smell to it, and it really is metallic-like, and you'll be able to start to smell this out when you see enough patients with GERD. Vomiting, if it gets high enough, obviously it can be expelled, and alarm symptoms, which we're going to go into. Now, the USMLE is going to expect you to know the difference between GERD pain and other types of quote-unquote chest pain. If you go back to the cardiology section, I did a talk on how to approach the patient with quote-unquote chest pain. Not all quote-unquote chest pain comes from cardiovascular causes. It can come from pulmonary causes, GI causes, psychiatric causes, and so forth. So this is a cause of chest pain. I can't tell you how many times patients have come into the ER and you see them and it's they complain of chest pain, and you get this patient in a room with chest pain. You're like, oh my gosh, it's an MI. And you go in, they're like, yeah, it burns, it radiates up my chest, I've been throwing up a little bit, and it comes on kind of at night when I lay down. That's reflux disease. So your differential includes angina pectoris. Angina is going to be a more of a crushing pain. It's going to be substernal. It's not going to have any rhyme or reason with food, and certainly not with laying down. Now remember that you have your stable angina, which comes on with exertion and improves with rest, your unstable angina, which just comes out of nowhere, including with rest, and then your coronary syndromes, which are include MI. I would say any patient who comes in and says the word chest pain, you should just get an EKG. It's very easy, very cheap, and you can rule out a heart attack. If you have a patient who comes in complaining of chest pain and you fail to get an EKG and they wind up dying of a heart attack, you're in for a lot of liability. Esophageal motility disorders, including achalasia, typically presents with dysphagia, so they've got pain with eating as opposed to just that burning sensation. Difficulty eating, they may have regurgitation. Peptic ulcer a lot of times comes on at night, and it's limited to the epigastrium. It does not radiate up the esophagus. It can be a gnawing pain, it's often described. Not so much burning, but it can be. So those are three important differentials when you have a patient coming in with belly pain. In a patient with presumptive reflux disease, your physical exam should pay special attention to the pulmonary system, because what are we concerned about with reflux disease, especially a patient who's been throwing up? We're concerned with aspiration. So look for wheezing, hoarseness, and cough. Can that happen without aspiration? Absolutely. Just a little bit of irritation of the larynx can result in some hoarseness. It doesn't necessarily have to get into the lungs, but you always want to have your guard up for aspiration. If you do suspect aspiration, it needs to be documented. You should get a CBC and a chest x-ray. Eroded tooth enamel is a sign of long-standing reflux disease, and you want to know about patients with long-standing reflux disease because these patients should get an EGD, upper endoscopy. Why? Because we're concerned about metaplastic changes in their esophagus. The longer you have reflux disease, the more likely that is to happen. I didn't put up a picture in this lecture of what eroded tooth enamel looks like, but definitely go in Google and look for that so you know what you're looking for. So be aware of alarm symptoms. Now, we talk about alarm symptoms when we're talking about lower GI issues, frequent diarrhea and stuff like that. But you also need to be wary of alarm symptoms for upper issues as well. So that's going to include weight loss. That's going to include anemia, heme-positive stools. So make sure that you're asking about stool color, especially dark or tarry-colored stools. If they do mention, yeah, I think my stools have been a little bit dark, blackish colored. A lot of patients don't come in for that because they don't think that dark is a normal or is an abnormal color for stools. And it can be difficult distinguishing brown from black. But if they say anything along those lines, you're going to be sticking a glove finger up their butt and getting a stool sample and checking for occult blood. Because we want to know about that. That's an alarm symptom, and these patients will immediately get an EGD. Dysphagia or odynaphagia suggests the possibility of a stricture or the possibility of cancer, long-standing reflux disease going on for multiple years, or reflux disease that has been treated in the past patient may still be on treatment and the symptoms really haven't gone away. Or if they're older than 50 years of age, that is kind of an alarm symptom as well, because the incidence of cancer goes up with age. For diagnosis, all patients over 50 should get an upper endoscopy at some point. Do you need to do it right away? No, not necessarily. If they're just over 50, you can get that upper endoscopy maybe a little bit later. Patients under the age of 50 with alarm symptoms, or really anyone with alarm symptoms, need to get an upper endoscopy sooner rather than later. Patients under the age of 50 and with a clear clinical picture of reflux disease and with no alarm symptoms can be diagnosed clinically, and that's going to be a lot of your patients. So in most cases, the diagnosis is clinical. You can try a therapeutic trial of acid suppression, typically proton pump inhibitors, and that can serve both for diagnosis and treatment. But your patients over the age of 50 should probably get an EGD at some point. Any patient with questionable GERD and no alarm symptoms, or who have persistent symptoms despite treatment, should get a 24-hour pH monitoring and manometry. Now, this is according to the book. How often in practice do we get 24-hour pH monitoring and manometry? Not really that often. So really, this is going to come down to those with persistent symptoms despite treatment who you refer off to a gastroenterologist, possibly for an EGD, and they may do this. But how often do you actually do this? Not often. Not often at all. So this is kind of a view of how we go about diagnosing. Now, I would say this down here in the bold face is really what you want to keep in your mind for the USMLE, because this is the most common way we go about treating. In patients without alarm symptoms, you can do a trial therapy of proton pump inhibitors, really any acid suppression, but proton pump inhibitors are our standard of care, so omeprazole, pantoprazole, etc. This is acceptable for diagnosis. If it goes away with proton pump inhibitors, you have a presumptive diagnosis of reflux disease. And you only do this, though, in patients without alarm symptoms. If they do have alarm symptoms, if they've got unintended weight loss, if they've got dark stools, heme positive, if they've got pain with eating, then you need to do an EGD. So all patients over 50 should get an upper endoscopy at some point, regardless of alarm symptoms. If it's questionable GERD or persistent symptoms despite treatment, they're probably going to be referred at some point to a gastroenterologist who will probably do a 24-hour pH test and manometry. If they're under 50 and they've got very obvious reflux disease, you can just go ahead and start treatment. But as I said, in many patients, you're just going to start a trial therapy of proton pump inhibitors. And if it improves, it's GERD. If it doesn't, then you may decide to do an EGD. So there's a couple ways going about this. This is, by the book. This is in practice. This is what gastroesophageal reflux disease looks like. This is a normal esophagus. You see it's nice and pink, sort of peach color. This is exactly what an esophagus should look like. As you can see with inflammation, you get this sort of erosion of the esophagus, and this is reflux. And that's just your scope right here. So you're doing some like retroflex, it looks like. Actually, this looks like they're doing a biopsy here. I can't really tell, but it looks like a biopsy. And you will get a biopsy when you do EGD, because you're going to be checking for Barrett's esophagus. So treatment, the standard of care is proton pump inhibitors, omeprazole, pantoprazole, etc. Antihistamines can be done, but they're less effective. So cimetidine, ranitidine, etc. They're not very effective. And in many patients, you're going to ultimately have to go on to proton pump inhibitors. So you might as well just start there, because there's really not a whole lot of adverse effects from the proton pump inhibitors. You might have some trouble absorbing magnesium or certain electrolytes like that, but really minimal side effects. Lifestyle modifications are always advisable, so things like weight loss, you can tell them to avoid food and water within 3 hours before bed. Anything that stretches the stomach is going to tell the stomach to make more acid, and that would be a problem. Avoid nicotine, alcohol, caffeine, chocolate, fried and fatty foods. All of those are going to raise the risk of reflux disease. They should plan smaller meals. Remember that anything that stretches the stomach is going to increase acid. So eating smaller meals but more often can help. At night, it can help to elevate the head of the bed and sleep on the left side. Remember, if you're sleeping on the left side, all of that contents in the stomach are going to go away from the sphincter. So even though that sphincter might relax at some point at night, you can keep the contents away. And on the other hand, if you're sleeping on the right side, you can see how that would be a problem. We don't really ever recommend lifestyle modifications alone. It's not very helpful. So proton pump inhibitors plus lifestyle modification. The ultimate treatment for reflux disease, if they fail proton pump inhibitors and lifestyle modification, and it is persistent reflux disease despite maximal treatment, you've done an EGD, you've ruled out Barrett's esophagus, you've ruled out, or maybe you have Barrett's esophagus, but you've ruled out other causes, you've ruled out cancer, you've ruled out stricture, then the ultimate treatment is surgical. It's called a Nissen fundoplication. Basically, you're taking the upper part of the stomach and wrapping it around the sphincter, and that tends to help. Like I said, candidates are usually those that have had persistent reflux disease despite maximal treatment. You can go and look at my surgery section, general surgery. I talk about the Nissen fundoplication in greater detail. Some complications are stricture, Barrett's esophagus, and esophageal cancer. I will just say that these patients who are put on proton pump inhibitors will typically need to be on proton pump inhibitors for life. There's a very high rate of relapse for patients that stop treatment. So these patients will need to, you need to constantly be refilling their proton pump inhibitors. I have a friend who's got reflux disease, and he's actually pretty young. He's only in his mid-20s. And he's had reflux disease for several years. I keep telling him, you need to go in for a scope, because nobody should have reflux disease that long, and it continues to be a problem for him. He was originally put on cimetidine, and it wasn't helping. And I told him that he needs, I don't write scripts for friends, but I told him, you need to go in and you need to get a prescription for a PPI. And he actually continues to have symptoms. He stops eating 2 hours before bed, but if he eats any time sooner than that before bed, he has some pretty serious symptoms. So he needs to go in and get a scope, but he still hasn't done that. So, you know, what can I do? Are my patients going to listen to me if my friends don't listen to me? I don't know. Maybe I need to work on my persuasive skills a little bit. So the big complication, Barrett's esophagus. Barrett's esophagus is a histologic diagnosis, so you're only going to diagnose it on EGD with biopsy. Barrett's esophagus is metaplastic change. It's premalignant, and basically it's just change of the mucosal cells, metaplasia of the mucosal cells of the lower esophagus, which should typically be normal stratified squamous epithelium, but it undergoes metaplasia and becomes simple columnar epithelium, and often there's goblet cells interspersed within the epithelium. So it is due to chronic acid exposure. The acid will trigger the cells to undergo metaplasia. And Barrett's esophagus is important because these patients have increased risk of adenocarcinoma. It is diagnosed with biopsy on histology. If there are only histologic changes, then you should repeat the upper endoscopy in 2 to 3 years. If you do notice dysplasia, so not metaplasia, dysplasia, basically pre-malignant changes, cancerous changes, abnormal cells, then you should repeat the upper endoscopy in 6 months, and this is assuming you're doing treatment. If there's high-grade dysplasia, then you need to remove the distal esophagus. So you need to know, Barrett's esophagus, it is metaplasia, metaplastic change, but we want to know, is there dysplasia? Is there cellular change? Is there abnormal mitoses, abnormal cells? If it's low grade, and you'll be told this by the pathologist, if it's low grade, repeat the upper endoscopy in 6 months. If it's high grade, you need to remove the lower esophagus. Of course, these patients should always be on proton pump inhibitors and lifestyle modifications. And I will just point out that there's a 5 to 15% incidence of Barrett's esophagus in patients seeking care for GERD. So that's why it's very important. Patients with long-standing GERD need to get EGD. This is what Barrett's esophagus looks like. It looks like just really severe erosion of the lower esophagus. You can't tell, really can't tell the difference between Barrett's esophagus and the changes that happen with reflux disease. That's why it needs to be diagnosed with biopsy. And also you need to get a biopsy in order to see if there's any dysplasia. This is what the normal esophagus looks like. Here you can see stratified squamous epithelium, glycogen-rich cells. This looks very normal. Notice the cells become flatter as they become more superficial, but this is stratified squamous epithelium. You should know that from your histology. Now notice the change with Barrett's esophagus. You have simple columnar epithelium. You have just one single layer of columnar cells, these sort of rectangular cells, and also notice that you have goblet cells up here. Now what kind of tissue does this look like? So look at, you've got these little goblet cells here, and you've got columnar epithelium. This is very typical of the epithelium that's seen in the colon. And so you'll hear a lot of the older gastroenterologists and pathologists refer to this as colonic metaplasia because it looks like colon cells. So that is all I have for you for reflux disease. If you have any questions, please write me a note below. Otherwise, I will see you next time. We'll be right back.